Welcome back to the Adam Sports Beat, coming to you from the Golf Club at Eagle Point Studios on this Wednesday. Dustin DePierre sitting in with me, Jim Coyle here, and Cal Nedrup, the Indianapolis Star, as promised, sitting in now. Cal, how's it going, brother?
Hey, good, guys. Thanks for having me on.
Great as always. I think I said this last week, and I'll say it again. I am just shocked at the quality of play that we've seen across the board in all sports, but high school especially, through this pandemic. The play has been pretty daggone good for a year that I was like, I don't know what to expect out there.
Yeah, it's been I probably covered the best game I've seen this season on Friday night. Westfield won 43-42 against Brownsburg. Super exciting game. It came down to a 2-point conversion in overtime and kind of a trick play reverse 2-pointer. Just really great environment and but honestly, the last few weeks, and that was a great game. I mean, really, really well played on both sides, I thought. And that was more about Westfield winning it than Brownsburg losing it. But, I've kind of noticed the last few weeks, and I may have mentioned this last week even, is just you kind of now, the first few weeks is kind of like, all right, just kind of fun to have high school sports back and football back. But, these last few weeks, I kind of have missed the crowds, and not that you can have full crowds back by any means, but it kind of feels like you're missing the environment of having a full student section and a game like that. There should be, people running on the field after the game and all that type of stuff. And I do kind of, I've noticed that the last 3 weeks, really, that some of these games that would have thousands of people at them can only have, whatever that county's restriction is. I think Brownsburg was around 1,200 or something like that. So you do miss some of that that extra stuff, the families. And I enjoy the families and the students can't go on the field after the game. So you kind of have free reign to get who you need, which is nice, but without battling the fans. But I do miss some of that stuff, and not to say it should be happening because it shouldn't be, but it is kind of a muted a little bit celebration. But I agree with you that the play on the field's been outstanding, and that's, I guess, what has been a really positive thing. And like I said, covered a great one on Friday. Most of the games I've covered, other than Center Grove just bashing everybody they play, those games haven't been too exciting, but other than that, I've covered some really good games, and it's from that standpoint, it's felt relatively normal this year. But I definitely do miss the crowds being there and the full stadiums. And like I said, that's something I've probably noticed here more the last couple of weeks, of just sort of missing that environment.
Dustin, you've been back on the high school beat a little bit too, haven't you, with the covering for the paper?
Yeah, I have been. I'm doing stuff for Franklin Daily Journal, so I've hit up a couple down that way, which brings me. I mean, that paper covers Center Grove as well, so I've been sort of following the other guys at the paper who've been covering those guys. How good is that Center Grove team? I mean, the scores are absurd. I mean, everything you see every week is just absolutely nuts, the degree to which they're dominating teams. You've seen a lot of great teams. Where do they rank, and do you think there's, who do you think can challenge them for a state title?
Yeah, and hello, Dustin. Good to see you.
You too, Cal.
it's been interesting because Center Grove, their defense is just on another level. And I always think when you have a defensive line that can dominate that way, that's maybe the most important aspect of any team to be able to kind of control what an offense is doing. So with Caden Curry and Austin Booker, those guys are Division I players, high level. Booker's going to Minnesota. Curry's got all kinds of, he can pretty much name his school wherever he wants to go. So those two are just completely, they have to double team Curry basically every game. That leaves Booker and others to kind of roam the field, and Curry still makes plays despite all that. But I would say it's partly because the Mick I would say is a little bit down. When you look at Warren, they lost a lot from last. They will be better, and I think they're still the next 2 years they're going to continually get better. And they're still kind of dangerous this year because their defense is really good. But they're down slightly. Ben Davis is down slightly. They're kind of in the same boat though. They're 2-4, but they're consistently getting better every week. And then you got teams like Lawrence North, which hasn't been good and is kind of having their best season. With Donovan McCulley and Omar Cooper and those guys. But again, they're not probably quite at that level to compete with Center Grove. We'll find out here next Friday when they play each other. But I'm not sure their defense can stop Center Grove. But I would put this Center Grove team on par right now with like the 2017 Ben Davis and 2018 Warren, which were really dominant teams offensively. This Center Grove team is probably better all around, I would say. Definitely better defensively. Probably not quite as explosive on offense as those two teams. But, you know, I wrote this a couple of weeks ago is, you know, this Center Grove team could go down as one of those all-timer type of teams when you go back and look at the history of Indiana high school football. You know, Warren Central of the mid-2000s, you know, you could even go back to, you know, Ben Davis of 91 and 2001. You know, there are teams littered throughout the history of high school football that this team, because of their, you know, if you look at their stats, it's amazing what they've accomplished so far. You know, if they continue on that pace, I think they will go down as one of those all-time teams. And I don't think you can forget these recent Warren and Ben Davis teams just because they're more recent either, because those teams were really dominant teams as well. The Reese Taylor Ben Davis team was they the only team that really challenged them was the Warren team. That the next year they were that team. So you know, those two teams were excellent, the best teams I've seen recently. This team, I think, is probably better defensively, but we'll see. I hope they get a challenge, really. I hope somebody can, and it may be Cathedral that last week of the season, to kind of give them a good run and put them in a position where they have to, you know, kind of battle in the second half. I think that'd be good for them, and it'd be fun to see, you know, just how they respond to that. But I think they'll respond well. They're seen, you know, Carson Steele is, haven't even mentioned him on the offensive side, and Taven Jackson, those guys are really good too. So I do hope they are challenged, and maybe it'll be Lawrence North next week, and maybe it'll be Cathedral the following week. But hard to see this team not, you know, making a run all the way to Lucas Oil in November.
I agree with you, Kyle, on how good they are as far as dominant. And all those teams that you mentioned, the thing about those teams is they were on the rise. They were kind of, man, they were there for a while, for at least for a blip. Center Grove, I'm not going to say they came out of nowhere, but I don't know that anyone expected this kind of dominance this year. I mean, you knew they were going to be good. They had the pieces in place. But, man, this is – when you mentioned them in the company of the teams that you just did, that's big time for this state.
Yeah, I mean, I remember walking out of Lucas Oil last year after they lost to Carmel in the state championship game. It was 20-17. And I think at that point, you know, they were only 8-6 to end the season. So it wasn't like they were dominant last year. They lost a lot of games. You know, New Pal beat them early in the year. I think they're 1-3, you know, to start the season, although they play a really tough schedule. You know, they weren't lighting the world on fire. But by the end, I remember walking out of the stadium and thinking, like, this is definitely the number one team going into next year, and partly because Taven Jackson played so well in the state championship game. You could kind of see his evolution becoming a, you know, dual threat, you know, big-time quarterback prospect, and we've seen that in his recruiting, too, kind of take off and you know, starting to get all these offers, you know, from Big Ten schools and others. You know, so I think that probably put them on another level. Is like, wow, he can throw, he can pass, you know, he can run. And you add Steele, who was hurt a lot of last year. So that was part of their problem too, is Steele wasn't even playing, up until the last three games of the year. And even then he wasn't full speed. So, you know, that kind of changed everything when he came back, and now he's fully ready to go. And they had Daniel Weems, who rushed for 1,000 yards last year, also coming back. So, just every position they had returning was kind of made them a clear number one. But you're right, Jim. I think the overall dominance of this team has been, you know, something of a surprise. And I think partly because they're so good, partly because the teams they're playing against are in sort of a reloading or rebuilding mode. So I think it's a combination of those two things. But I think still the tougher challenges, like I said, are still to come. Lawrence North, I think, will have – you know, a senior-led team that is going to be able to put up some kind of points against them. I don't know how many. And then Cathedral, I think, is probably maybe the closest team to being on par with them from all areas. So these next 2 weeks, they play Pike this week, and then the next 2 weeks I think will be really interesting.
Well, you mentioned Cathedral. There's been a lot of Indiana teams, and it's happened many times before, but it seems like more this year, but playing a lot of Cincinnati teams. I think I've seen at least four games already, and Cathedral takes on Elder this week. That's Peyton Ramsey. That's right. That's his old school. They played Floyd Central earlier, but that's going to be a – man, there you go right there. Elder was good. They put up a lot of points against Floyd Central, so we know Cathedral's good. That could be another great game right there.
Yeah, Cathedral's going to their – this is their Bill Belichick stage, on to Cincinnati portion of their schedule. They're this is their third Cincinnati opponent in a row. They play Elder. They already beat St. Xavier and LaSalle, who – LaSalle was a state champion last year, and they've been challenged in both those games, and I think will only kind of help them when they get into the tournament. But – you know, really, it's hard to see any 5A team. You kind of wish Cathedral was 6A this year just to see, you know, how they would stack up, because I'm not sure 5A is going to have much of anything for them. Not to say there's not good teams, but they're, this Cathedral team might be the best overall Cathedral team I've seen since I've been, you know, this is probably what, my 12th or 13th year doing this, and I don't think they've had a team to this level, even though they've had state championship teams. So, it'll be fun to see what, you know, they do against Center Grove, what they do this week against Elder, their third week in a row against a really good Cincinnati team. And I wonder how many teams in Indiana have gone undefeated against Ohio teams, especially of that caliber. That would be quite a accomplishment.
Especially that many.
Yeah. I mean, it's hard to, normally those Ohio teams, I would guess win at least 75% of those matchups. And those are normally good Indiana team, so that's a chance, another chance to get a good win. And Brownsburg, of course, had the win over St. Xavier too. So Indiana kind of getting the better of that that matchup this year. So it'll be good. I mean, Nathan McCahill's been awesome for Cathedral this year. You know, again, they're a team that's really explosive offensively, and their defense has probably been better than what Bill Peebles had thought going into the year to be able to hold those teams down, those really good teams down. But the game of the year really could be the Cathedral Center Grove, that last game of the regular season, to kind of see where both of those teams stack up. And I can't wait to see what it is. I hope they're, you know, kind of selfishly hope they're both undefeated going into that. And then you kind of have a mythical, you know, regular season state championship sort of environment going into that one.
Yeah, I can't. That'll be must-see TV. Lots of great games all over the place as well in other parts of the state. Fort Wayne Lures and Bishop Dwenger. Dwenger has IU Commit via Vinny Fia Cable. Evansville, there's a ton of games down there. Harrison, Evansville Central, Memorial taking on Wrights. Castle and Jasper. Jasper kind of having a resurgence. I think they were ranked third in the last week. I can't remember if that was the week before or not. But Jasper having a little resurgence. That's a long-time proud program there.
Yeah, Jasper, I know they got beat by Evansville Central this past week by a touchdown, but definitely back on the rise. And Evansville Central, one of those teams too, that they've risen up to, I think, number three this week themselves in the 4A poll, three or four. But 4A's been kind of a fun class since they went to the six class system, because it's kind of opened things up for some of the public schools. A lot of the private schools had dominated 3A and a lot of them stayed 3A. So now 4A, you've kind of had a rotating door of kind of, you know, teams that have kind of come from losing records. And we've seen that with Mooresville and Mount Vernon here locally. They have kind of bounced back. Their programs have got on solid footing now. And that's been a class that's kind of been fun to watch because it's been so wide open year to year. But yeah, now Jasper and Evansville Central. I know they had a really good game down there last week, and Evansville Central got the better of that one. But looks to be Jasper back, you know, kind of on the rise in football again.
And Vincennes, Lincoln, Evansville North, I see tangling this week. That should be another good one. What's good game are you going to, Kyle?
I'm actually going to go down and cover Whiteland and Mooresville this week, and that should be a good game. Whiteland's 5-1. Mooresville 6-0. They have a couple Purdue recruits on their offensive line, and Mike Gillens, you know, actually covered this game 2 years ago. It was a great game, and that was at the time Mooresville was kind of just starting to turn the corner again. But Mike Gillen, you know, always known for his passing offenses and exciting style of play. So looking forward to seeing that one. Should be a good one. Another one to watch around here. Merrillville comes down and plays Bishop Chittard on Friday night. That's one of those rescheduled pickup games, basically, because both schools had opponents that had canceled on them. So Merrillville, number two in 6A, and we kind of get to find out, you know, what they're made of against a local team. So that'll be a fun game to kind of keep an eye on as well. But it's kind of a mixed, not as many huge games on the schedule this week, but looking at next week, there's some good ones coming, but should be a fun night. I'm looking forward to that Whiteland-Mooresville game. I haven't seen either one yet this year.
I hope the weather stays good. You stay dry. We're starting to get the fall, man. I cannot thank you enough as always.
Yeah, absolutely. We're 6-for-6. I tweeted that out, and then I got blasted for jinxing it for everybody. So that's my fault.
Make sure you give him a follow, Kyle Nedrip at the Indy Star. Follow him on Twitter as well. Thank you, brother. I appreciate you.
All right. See you guys. Thanks for having me on.